You're listening to Discovering the Truth with Dan Duvall. Well, folks, I am ready to introduce you to a very special person that you have not heard on the podcast before. This will be your debut on our podcast, but certainly this woman of God has been doing kingdom work for a very long time. Her name is Barb Bucklin, and she is the founder of Luke 418 Ministries. They are based out of Austin, and you can find them at luke-418.com. They are a ministry that focuses on deliverance and inner healing, a lot like ourselves, but they're very interested in the territory and region. They go out to the streets, they evangelize, and Barb is known for hosting conferences in the Austin region, one of which I was actually invited to a couple months ago, where I had the privilege of meeting her in person. And I've invited her on the podcast to share some of the abundance of her wisdom with us. Folks, this is Barb Bucklin, and Barb, it is so good to have you on the program.
Well, it was wonderful to meet you. I thought that was, I knew it was a divine appointment, Dan. And so good to be talking to you again, because I know that we have similar hearts, similar purposes, really have such a passion to see God's people come free. And so it's wonderful to be in the mix of people that are speaking the same language, right? Who we call them gentle protectors, but gentle protectors who also understand the warfare and the battle that's needs to go on to see God's people walk in their destiny. So it's good to be with you.
Amen. Well, likewise, I was just blown away when I got to meet you and all your folks down in Austin, making some new friends and just finding kindred hearts. It was just wonderful.
Yeah. We are really blessed. God has given us a team for a long time. We did it with just one or two people, and it was sort of undercover when we started, as far as deliverance is concerned, even as far as healing concerned. We got into a lot of trouble in my local church for praying for healing and breaking curses and doing that when we started. And so it was pretty undercover, off the radar for years, and then suddenly there was more and more demand for it, and the Lord said to start to multiply. So we started to run classes to teach what we know, both in healing rooms and at the deliverance table. So you're helping us do that when you come to Austin, because it helps to activate people and make them more and more aware of what God's call really is for the body of Christ, for the ecclesia in this time, right? I just know that there's going to be so many people that are coming out that need healing and need freedom, and most of the body is not prepared to walk in that place. But we want to raise up as many people who are part of the solution and not part of the problem.
Oh my gosh, you word that so well. You know, Barb, one of my big concerns is that there is a groundswell of broken people that are realizing they are broken and are looking for solutions. And while it's been under the radar for a long time, I don't think that's going to be the case too much longer. And and when the groundswell bursts, it's like, my concern is, what are we going to do?
yeah, exactly. we've got two deliverances here all week, plus a couple every day this week, plus a couple follow-ups in the afternoon. So that takes, well, probably you'll have a dozen different people at the table working with the beloveds. And that's kind of the pace that we're on now. And we're booked out into January. And that is, for us, that just seems like forever and a day, because of course, mostly people call feeling that they're already in a place of emergency, right? And you hate to have them wait 3 months for, we always keep some emergency appointments open for people that are really in bad places, but that's still a long way to be out. It would be wonderful to be able to say, well, we'll see you in 2 weeks, right? Or even next week. We used to be able to do that, but no longer. But we do pray in the healing room as well. And we pray at Church Under the Bridge too, which is the church for homeless people. And we are seeing some pretty amazing deliverances and healings in short periods of time, 15 minutes, a half hour, God really breaking through in areas for people.
So let me ask you this. Before we get into joy and even how joy affects the brain, which I am very, very excited to have you talk about, I want you to just give us a little window into Barb Bucklin and how your journey took you from, you know, beginning to now. I mean, what was the call of God, and how did he put this in your heart?
Well, I'm not a longtime believer. I don't know that you knew that. I didn't really come to the Lord until I was in my 50s. I'm 82. So I really didn't come to the Lord until I was in my 50s. And we moved from Santa Fe, New Mexico to Austin, Texas, because my husband had lung problems, and he died shortly after we got to Austin. But the Lord then took me to Dallas, actually, to a meeting with Ed Silvoso, who was in the city. I don't know, do you know Ed, Harvest Evangelism?
I am familiar with him. But I don't know.
Yeah, he's an Argentine, and he was very much involved in the Argentine revivals and with all those pastors who were involved in that long-term move of the Lord. And I went up to Dallas to a meeting of his, and before I left there, I had signed up to go on the summer mission trip, not realizing that virtually everybody else on the trip would be somewhere between 15 and 25, right? But it was an awesome trip, and it was the first time I had seen the church move in power. And we saw salvations, healings, deliverances. Ed had a prayer fair in the park the last afternoon we were down there. Things, you know, the weather changed. They had access to the archbishop, to the mayor. I mean, they had so many breakthroughs. It should have been rainy and gray and cold in the summertime, our summertime in July, but we had 85 degree weather, just broke all sorts of records. And they had no major accidents, no major crimes in the city. The newspaper actually came to the training camp where we were to find out what the heck was going on. And so I thought, well, that was a whole different thing than I've ever seen with the body of Christ, right? We were suddenly very relevant in the city.
Wow.
And Ed was using then, 1997, that was, he was using the words city reaching and shifting the spiritual climate by prayer. And he is all about prayer and blessings and spiritual warfare. So we were going out on spiritual warfare missions down there all hours of the night, and then ministering in churches in the evening. And so that was my introduction to a church that believed in all the gifts of the Spirit. Mm-hmm. And I came back from there knowing that what God had done in this town of San Nicolas, Argentina, he wanted to do in Austin. So that word transformation has been in the front lobes of my mind ever since. But of course, I came back and nobody else was speaking that language, right?
Right.
And they are now. So that's the good news. And we've already seen so much change in Austin as a result of the prayer movement in the city over the years. When I started working in the city, which was 98 or so, it was known as the pastor's graveyard. And we did the Jesus Video Project, which you may remember back in 2000, 2001, we mailed about 4 million videos in the state of Texas. And I was the prayer coordinator for that.
Wow.
At that time, I mean, nobody was talking to anybody. And if they were, it was more of a definitely a competitive spirit in the city. I met with three pastors one day in the same zip code, and two of them were from the same denomination. And the pastor from the largest church of the three said to me, "Barbara, we're going to do the video project, but I have no desire to work with these other two churches." And he walked out of the room. But that was the tenor of what was going on in the city.
Mm-hmm.
It was really nasty. And now it's a totally different city, right? We had 350 churches joined together to do Explore God, and then the Reach Your Neighbor project 2 years ago, and they're going to be doing another project probably in the spring, which will be based on a book by John Burke, one of the pastors in the city, about heaven. So that takes them into a supernatural realm they sure never have been in before. But it's really wonderful to see the difference in the pastors praying and working together.
That is
so, yeah, huge. In the process of that, when I came back 2 weeks, we were doing a lot of street work in Argentina. And 2 weeks after I came back, someone from my church called and said, "You want to go to church under the bridge with me, to the homeless church?" And I did. And we just, I'd learned so much about prayer while we were down there that we went to the bridge, and people just started praying the way I was praying then, right, catching it. And we saw all sorts of healings and deliverances at the bridge. And so that was the beginning of it. And then a missionary friend and I started to do Freedom in Christ, and we knew that wasn't enough. And one day a pastor's mom called me that I had never met. She had just moved here from Oregon, and she said the Lord had told her to give me a prayer pattern that they used in Oregon for deliverance, because I would use it. So we went up and went through deliverance with her, and she gave us a prayer pattern. We picked it up and started using it just casually, but we saw amazing results. And that's still the basis of our prayer manual. It begins and ends with that prayer that we got from her that day. So that's kind of the journey. And of course, I had a pastor tell me one day that the Lord had told him that he said, "I just wanted to bless you," because the Lord had told him that he had asked two men to do what I was doing and they would not do it. So he said it was just a sweet word of confirmation from him, just a blessing for taking that role and leading deliverance and supernatural healings in the city. So that's kind of my story. I just know that that God has more for us, right? And we got a word, last February that we were in a new realm. That's a word you use. And that God was moving at warp speed and we better be ready. So it was just like an uptick and an upgrade. And so we've just been watching him move really fast. And he also had told me that we have, Luke 4:18 has, because of the deliverance and the freedom, we have what the pastors need. And so we have seen several pastors, even in the last 2 months, come and want to talk about deliverance in their church and how do they get trained to do it. So that's big time breakthrough.
I'll tell you what, Barb, if Caleb had a female counterpart, it would probably be you.
Oh, that's I'll take that. I'll take it. The funny thing is that people say all the time, they probably say it to you too, but isn't deliverance just really, heavy duty? And sometimes it is, but the truth of the matter is that when you see God move and Jesus come in and set somebody free in a few hours work, it's such a faith builder, right? And that he just wants to extend that to the whole body of Christ so everybody can walk in the destiny that he has prepared for them. So that's what we're about doing, and we just see it as a joyful journey, to be able to be used in that way and to pick up that mandate.
Thank you for that.
Uh-huh.
So Now that we know you a little bit better, Barb, let's talk about joy. All right.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I meet a lot of Christians. Okay? I'm sure you
Yeah.
have too. Barb, they're not happy people.
No. They're like no joy,
Now,
right?
they're not.
Yeah.
There's no. It's kind of confusing, actually. Because, and this is what even gets me really confused, is that when you are too happy around them, they're mad at you. Like, you have a problem.
Oh, yeah. That's exactly right. It's
And,
like being talking a foreign language, right?
like, you're happy, Dandoval?
Yeah.
How dare you be in a good mood talking about the things you talk about? Do you not know?
Right.
It's like, but I know Jesus. Like,
Yeah.
so I want to talk about joy with you. When you brought it up, I got really excited. I'm like, yes, we need this, because I'm tired,
Yeah.
Barb, of people being so
Oh, we
upset at
ever need
me
it, right?
for being happy.
Yeah. That's well, you know, and joy, we've kind of flipped over to the Passion Translation, which maybe makes it even more so. But when you look at the scripture, joy's there from the beginning to the end. And there's such wonderful scriptures, you know. There's this one in Philippians where it says, "Complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of the same mind. Complete my joy." That's what he's talking about. The verse that we quote all the time, "The joy of the Lord is your strength," right? But then there's that Proverbs verse that says, "A joyful heart is good medicine, but a crushed spirit dries up the bone." There's so many scriptures which hook joy to healing and to health. And if you just think of the kingdom scripture itself, it's one of the key ones for me is it's righteousness, peace, and joy, empowered by the Holy Spirit. So joy is, and it's in the fruit of the Spirit, right? Right up there on top. But in the church, we've just lost that. Because I think, well, the enemy's stolen it from us. We just don't understand the meaning of joy, how we get there, and how we sustain it, right? Because what we see at the deliverance table is people can walk in here really depressed and leave here really in joy. They have to maintain it later, but they've had a truth encounter, which brings them to that place of joy in a couple of hours. That makes sense to you? I know it makes sense to you.
Well, now I have a question.
Okay.
All right, Barb. You mentioned stolen joy. How does joy get stolen?
Well, I think one of the key things is that people don't know who they are, for one thing, in Christ. And they don't know what their inheritance is. They don't know the relationship. They don't really believe. There's lots of, I see unbelief as a major stronghold in the church. So that if you're walking in that unbelief, if you're, I say, well, we're all on the tree of knowledge of good and evil instead of the tree of life, right? Walking in the wrong tree and sitting in the wrong tree. Joy and peace and Jesus are all in the tree of life. And we're sitting over there believing the junk that's in the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And so we don't know the truth, and we don't know the real purpose of our being here. And so those things lead to fear with the double-mindedness and the doubt and the unbelief. And I think that's where most of the body of Christ is trapped in unbelief. And in fear. And if you got those two going, it's not easy to sustain joy. You have to be really walking. Word says to be solidly grounded, right? Deep roots. And those deep roots and understanding who he made us to be and that relationship and having conversations with him are the things that make the difference. We do something called a manual journaling, and there's a, let me pull out the passion, because there's a scripture there that really, really speaks about joy. When he's talking about wisdom, In Proverbs 8, it says, and this is Passion Translation, "So listen, my sons and daughters, to everything I tell you, for nothing will bring you more joy than following my ways." That's really direct, right?
Mm-hmm.
"Listen to my counsel, for my instruction will enlighten you to be wise. You will be wise not to ignore it. If you wait at wisdom's doorway, longing to hear a word for every day, joy will break forth for you within you as you listen for what I'll say. For the fountain of life pours forth within you as you listen for what I'll say every day. And this is the secret of growing in a delight and the favor of the Lord." So joy is used three times in that little scripture, just being obedient, listening to his ways, listening to his voice. And I know for us here, one of the key things we want to do for people that are at the deliverance table is that before they leave the table, they hear his voice, because so many people don't think that's possible. So we want to break through that barrier so they can have that conversation with him and learn his ways directly from him as well as from scripture, because it's his voice, I believe, that makes a huge difference for people, that relationship.
That's so good. One of the things that kind of drifted into my brain while you were talking, I just want to throw out there and see how you respond to this. I think that people have a habit of sowing bad seed into the fields that they would otherwise be able to reap joy from. For instance, people sow bad seeds into their marriage. And I believe that one of the number one places God wants us to reap joy is from our marriage. And since we sow a lot of bad seeds into this field, this area, it's like when we go to, okay, extract a harvest from that area of our lives, it's a bad crop.
We don't want to look around and see most of the time, right?
We don't even want to go home anymore. It's like, oh my gosh, I don't want to go home to this. Like, you know, but there's so much bad seed in that field.
Is that not the devil's playground and joy? It's his joy to see that happen, right? That's his goal, is to divide and conquer.
So then we go and we sow bad seed into our relationship with our children through disappointment, provocation to anger, all kinds. And so instead of being able to reap joy, there's division and heartbrokenness. And
kids that don't really, because of the relationship at home, they don't really have healthy bonding with their parents. And then they don't have they really don't have the strong and secure attachments with the parents, no less God, right? Because they've never seen that modeled for them. I believe the way to catch this stuff is to see it modeled. So if we don't see joy modeled in our pastors or in our mother and dad, we come out low joy is what happens. One of the things that, you know, that joy is actually the core of how our brain wants to learn. I mean, joy is so important in our brain, the way God made it. And it's that joy that's the basic for strong, those attachments, you know, that bonding. It's all about joy. It's that mom and dad that see that little baby and want to make it smile, right? I had a pastor say to me the other day, he's been ministry for years, he said, "I got all shook up when I heard Jim Wilder talk about joy." And he said, "Because I just thought joy was being happy doing ministry, that I could have joy all by myself." And he said, "It was a shock to me to find out that joy was relational, that that's the way it's built and that's the way it's strengthened. It's all about somebody who's glad to be with you." So if you don't have somebody that's glad to be with you, you for sure are going to be low joy. And that leads to all the isolation and the, you know, the silence and the withdrawal in people's lives. And of course, the screens that everybody on, I think that just heightens that, right? That ability to stay in your own silo and not react with people. And that would make low joy, because you need the one-on-one, eye-to-eye contact to build joy. That's how joy is built. So the enemy has a field day when you're looking at a screen, because that is not a joy builder. It won't happen.
Wow. That's powerful.
Isn't that something?
It is something.
Yeah. The right front orbital prefrontal cortex, right, which that's a whole mouthful, but the right side of your brain is almost not there when the baby's born. And it actually forms chemically on the basis of the face that's looking at it. So if you have a face that's filled with joy and loves to be with the baby, just happy as could be, and you get that smile going back and forth, that's what those first months are, is just really building joy. If you have that kind of a face looking at a baby, the baby will have one particular kind of brain. It'll have a chemical setup for joy and peace.
So
those two go together.
When babies,
but if you have a face that's angry,
yeah,
or depressed, or in a lot of cases a face that isn't even there, right? They will have a whole different chemical makeup in that right frontal area, and they will be low joy. So they don't have, as if that happens to them as a baby, Jim Wilder calls it a joy bucket that we have in that front part of our brain. If they have a low joy bucket, and if they have something that happens along their life that's causes them to fear or puts them in depression, they don't have any reservoir of joy to come out of that place. So that's why we see people get so stuck in emotions when they don't have enough joy to take them out of those places of shame or fear or hopeless despair. They just get stuck there. And you can stay a long time in that nasty place, right? But it's because they don't have a joy bucket to depend on.
Now that is fascinating.
Isn't that fascinating?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So we can get people delivered from depression and so forth, you know. However, the next step is that they ought to be doing some brain work to rebuild joy. That's really the, that's, I know we don't have the bandwidth to do that. That's what I would love to have, is classes going all the time on joy and on relationships and on maturity, all those classes, right? Because the people that you're dealing, and you know, most of the people, well, it's not just people that are coming for deliverance, because you walk in churches and you think, ooh, nobody's very happy in this place, right? what's missing here? So we need to do some work to rebuild that joy, because that's what makes us resilient. It's what makes you able to suffer well when you have that joy.
That's profound. Okay, so brain work is actually part of the solution set.
Yes, totally.
And that is a new grid for some people, you know. Some people think,
yeah,
It's just about, you know, sitting through enough Bible teachings, but it's not.
No, it's not. No. And what I've also learned about the brain is that, you know, so the right-hand side of your brain is your identity center. It's where there's joy. And the good news about that, even if you're low joy, that part of your brain can always grow and change. So even if you start out joyless, right, that can change. It's the only part of your brain that really keeps changing your whole life. But it's, you know, scriptural. It's what you look at, what you think about, what you spend time with that's going to affect your mind, right? So this is really true about that right side of your brain, your right front part of your brain. And it really also, that same part of your brain defines how others see you. and what we want to be. It defines how you feel about things and how you handle things. That's all in that same section. So if you have high joy, you're going to have a nature that will be positive about circumstances instead of looking at all the negatives all the time. If you have low joy, everything is going to appear a disaster, right?
Well,
or fearful or scary, right? You're going to be, and then you get stuck in that place, and then you make, what we know too is that you make really bad decisions when the front of the brain isn't working well. And the front of the brain functions best when there's joy and peace there to make good decisions.
So sometimes you could actually make the argument that a person is predisposed to making bad decisions based on brain malfunction.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Don't say that too loud.
We've got a fear center in our brain. You know, when you look at it, you've got a fear center in your brain. Uh-huh. And so that fear center, when you get a thought, it comes in way in the back of your right side of your brain. And the thought goes oops, over your right side of the brain, and then it flips over to your left side where your file cabinets are. So a thought has a definite track in your brain. And if you get stuck back there where there's fear, and that's your normal place of operating, you can't make good decisions. And then if you complicate that with drugs, right, which also helps to limit your ability to make good decisions, the way the drugs affect your mind and your brain, it's one more reason why you won't make good decisions.
My gosh.
So we have on the right side of the brain something that's called the cingulate cortex, and that's where you get your mutual mind level. It's where your sharing center is and your conscious level, and it involves emotional processing and so forth. So that's another step. First comes the back of the mind where that thought is evaluated, whether it's going to go forward or whether it's something that's just inconsequential and it's not something that you have to concentrate on. So that thought goes in from there into the next area where it says, oh, this is okay, or it's bad and scary. And if it's bad and scary, you could get stuck in that fear place and never move that thought to the next level. And then it goes down to the cingulate cortex, and then finally up into the right part of your brain where all your creative ability is too. And then finally, if it's a thought that you can really handle, it'll shift over to the left side of your brain where your file cabinets are. One thing we know about those file cabinets is that all those files, it's really stubborn, really hard to change. And it doesn't change just by teaching and scriptures. What they find is that it has to be something experiential that'll shift the left part of your brain. So to me, the experiential thing is really an encounter with Jesus. When you have the encounter with Jesus, that changes everything.
Amen.
Right?
That's good. Well, you know, and this,
yeah, so it's the brain is really important. I mean, he made it so it was obviously important, right? And he made it so that it can be the basis of joy, or it can be the, you know, or you can get stuck in trauma, and that's where you don't want to be.
So you've mentioned a lot of keys as we've been talking here. And I want to come back,
mm-hmm.
because you mentioned that we don't know the meaning of joy.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what is the meaning of joy?
That's a good question, right? Well, the way that we've come to determine it is that joy is being glad that someone's with you. It's all about relationship. All about relationship. So you don't build joy by yourself. You don't build joy on a screen. It's all about somebody who is really glad to be with you. And that's a relationship with the Lord, right? And then it's a relationship with other people that you love and care for. So it's all a relational issue. It's not just something that's, oh, I'm joyful today. You're joyful and you build joy basis on the basis of people being glad to be with you.
My goodness.
That makes sense?
And it's amazing because our society is such a society of isolation.
Right, and getting more so.
And more so as the years go by, you know, mm-hmm. it actually mm-hmm. takes more and more effort to, and now that was going to be my next example of bad seed, you know, because there's flaky people, Barb, that they say things like, oh, we should get together, but then they never call, or they get a phone call and never return it, but say the same thing the next time you see them in person. And then you say, why are they so flaky? And, you know, I think what we don't realize when we do things like this, we're actually robbing ourselves of an opportunity for joy.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And the amazing thing, too, is that that's all a baby wants to do. Uh-huh. When it's born, that you know, all it wants to do and all a mother's job and dad's job should be building joy. And joy, that ability to build it, builds in at 3 months and at 9 months. So, you know, when you have moms that are going back to work at 3 months, it's just exactly the time they should be with their baby to build joy. They could spend their whole day building joy. And they prove, I mean, there's studies that are out there saying that'll tell you really clearly, if you have that joy built in, you are way less likely to use drugs or end up in prison. I mean, it's so important, right, to have that foundation built of joy. I was in a meeting with Jim Wilder and Marcus Werner, who wrote a new book called Rare Leadership. I don't know, have you seen the book?
I have not.
I think you'd love it. And it talks a lot about these principles. We were at a meeting in San Antonio at a big church where he was presenting this material. And so they were talking away about joy and leadership and so forth. And about 10:30 in the morning, a guy who was on staff of this big church raised his hand and he said, "You guys keep talking about joy." He said, "What does joy have to do with the church?" Okay, right. Of course, it gave them the wonderful opportunity to start quoting joy scriptures, right? But I think it was, I mean, this guy wasn't kidding. He was honest. He was serious, right? What does joy have to do with the church?
I love your definition of joy. I love joy.
You like that?
Joy is being glad that someone is with you. Wow.
Yeah. Wow. And what we know, we just have taught a manual this weekend, manual journaling and so forth, and taught it at the Austin Disaster Relief Network, which deals with disaster people. But I mean, disasters happen all the time, right, for people. Mm-hmm. But the truth is that all you need is one person to be with you in a disaster, to listen to you, that somebody knows, somebody cares about them, just one person. And it'll keep them from having a breakdown. One person will make the difference in whether somebody can get through a situation and stay together, or if they'll end up with a breakdown of some kind. Isn't that amazing?
And I just think about God's vision for marriages here, Barb.
Uh-huh.
Because marriages are so horribly attacked. Mm-hmm. But that statement that you made just reveals God's wisdom is like, look, one way through which the Lord sends us out two by two is in the context of the covenant of marriage.
Mm-hmm.
And a man holds the woman up and a woman holds the man up. And together, if they're flowing in unity and in fellowship, how powerful is that?
Absolutely. Oh man, and isn't that that's what he had in mind, right?
A body of Christ full of people with healthy marriages, And this is where I just see the strategy of the enemy, you know, because you have opportunity, you know, men all over the country have opportunity to sow into the field of intimacy with their spouse.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But instead, they quite literally take seed and sow it into another field of isolation and loneliness called pornography.
Right. Right.
And rob the marriage. Now, again, that's actually destroying joy for multiple parties.
Oh, totally. Totally. That's rob, steal, destroy, right? Kill, steal, destroy. Kill the marriage. Kill the relationship with the kids. I mean, it's devastating. We had a young one here just in the last couple of days who just coming off. Well, she's clean, but, you know, she's had a couple of years struggle with drugs. And because of, I mean, it was because mom and dad were fighting all the time, right? I mean, she was the typical low joy little girl in a house that had everything physically, financially, but no joy in the house. And she always felt rejected, never could make it. Dad was never there. Mom was angry all the time, right? So it's like, oh, so she, to cover her pain and her hurt and her rejection, what she felt as rejection and abandonment because they weren't there, she started using drugs when she was 15. But that's the fallout, right?
Yeah.
You'll look for joy someplace to cover the pain. So you self-medicate somewhere. That's, to me, that's the key reason for the drugs. If kids had that proper bonding with their parents and joy built in them, they wouldn't all be falling into the drug trap.
So children that have the opportunity to have parents that are building joy into them when they're 0 to 3 months, 3 to 6 months, so on and so forth, you're suggesting they're going to just be much more well-adjusted.
Much more. Yeah. Yeah. And they have, you know, the brain, when we're talking about the brain, it has, you know, critical times of development too. You know, so much is set between 2 and 9 months.
Mm-hmm.
That's, you know, when the core of the brain is set, and your joyful identity of the child actually is between 6 and 12 months. So by the time they're a year old, that's pretty well set. And by 5 and 6 months, even they have a theory of who they are. So those things are established in a little one. You know, that's that when you see parents that don't know how to raise kids, right, or ignoring them, or you know, whatever, they don't understand the critical portion of their brain development is before they're 3 years old. So it's so important that they see modeled love and people caring for each other, that, you know, they're truly the apple of mom and dad's eyes, right?
Mm-hmm.
They get the proper kind of attention. And if they fall into fear, just like you'd pick up a kid, right, and pick him up and just encourage him. If he's fearful or fallen and he's crying, if that little child doesn't have that, it's devastating to him in the long run. And it sets him up for all sorts of emotional issues later on in life. Those first few years are critical in their development, for their brain and for their joy level and everything else that goes on about them. Their ability to make good decisions even come really early in life.
So let me ask you this. How has this understanding impacted your ministry style?
How has what?
Understanding the role of joy, even in development, impacted your ministry style.
Totally. And people will say to us all the time, oh, God, you guys are so happy, right? Or you come into the house and, oh, you're all so joyful. What's going on here, right? But that's, you know, that's what the Lord's, he's shown us how important this stuff is. And of course, once you're free, you become more joyful if you're focusing on the Lord. And if you're with people that are glad to be with you. So we build, joy is actually built by looking at each other in the eye and transmitting it. Goes back, I don't know how many times a second, really fast. So just that eye-to-eye contact with people that are full of joy, you can transfer, you can download joy to another person. That's part of this, the exercise that you do if you're trying to retrain your brain. So we're focused on ministering to people out of a place of joy when you're talking about that. Same thing in our healing rooms. People will say that all the time. Oh my goodness, where are all these happy people come from? Because that's who we're supposed to be. We're supposed to be alternating to me joy and peace. And that's what a baby does. You know, you see a mom stimulating a baby, for instance, laugh, 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 tickle, right? Mm. And then all of a sudden you'll see a baby turn away and quiet. And so he's kind of reached his capacity level as far as joy is concerned, and he'll turn away and rest. And that, I believe, is the frequency of heaven. It's joy and peace. Shalom. And the enemy doesn't have anywhere to get you when you're walking in joy and peace. That's what we try to show people and to teach people, right? That those two are really key to your being able to hold on to deliverance and to hold on to your freedom, is to have those two ingredients. That makes sense?
So you mentioned earlier in this program the idea of walking in joy.
Mm-hmm.
And you're using that in the ministry process, in demonstration, mm-hmm. and you're intentionally pulling people in that direction.
Absolutely.
Brilliant.
Yeah. Yeah. Because a lot of them have been out of a joy mode for, I don't know, 5, 10, 20 years. Maybe they've never really experienced joy their whole life. So then the negative emotions are all running, right? And they see everything, you know, it's that glass that's always half empty. There's never any hope, right? Hopeless despair comes in, and then, boy, before you know it, somebody's in a place of self-pity or shame or condemnation, whatever it is, and they don't know how to come out of that place until they get rid of, I mean, I believe it's a spiritual issue, getting rid of those demonic entities, right? And then being, it's a truth encounter, right? Believing the truth of who God says you are. But the goal is for them to be walking in joy. Yeah. Real joy. Not fake joy. Not just the smile. You know, not the facade that people wear, right? Not the mask that you wear to church. But real joy. You know, when you think about Jesus on the cross, he was, right? So he was able to say, forgive them.
Yeah.
For they don't know what they do, right? He was who he was up to the very last minute. And the word says that he went to the cross for the joy set before him. So joy is so integral and so important in our walk. And it draws people. Mm. And joy and peace are, they're, you know, they go viral. When you're with somebody that's really joyful and peaceful, when you see that combination, man, you want to be with that person, right? You recognize that they've got something that you don't have. So if the body of Christ was walking in that place, you would have people coming in. Well, they'd be beating down the doors to get in there where there's joy and peace and people that are encouraging, people that really talk life and destiny over people, speak life.
Well, you know, joy seems to attract different kinds of responses under different circumstances. And I agree, you know, in a majority of cases, especially if the joy is the environment that's been set, like, yeah, people want that. But there's something about a religious spirit, Barb.
Oh, yeah.
There's something about the religious spirit. It hates joy. It's right. Like a joy usurper. It's like the toilet bowl that flushes joy down the drain. The religious spirit, And because I've been in this thing, right? It's like a vortex of negativity. It comes from every angle. Every time you turn around in a religious environment run by the spirit, it's attacked.
Yeah, well, really, I mean, isn't that religious spirit all the trappings of religion without relationship?
So brilliant. That is so brilliant. Yes, because religion is all of the legalities of the faith without the relationship with Jesus, the vital part. That is just too much, Barb.
Yeah, so well, that's good. And that's why we tried to teach people. We teach them all the time. We teach them, and this came from Jim Wilder, Emmanuel Journaling, you know, but listening to the voice of God. And it's just a real simple, the questions about, that you ask God for his advice and his perspective on things. I mean, when I heard people pray, I never heard anybody talk about listening. They just talked, right? I mean, even that Acts way of praying, there was never any talking about listening to what God had to say about what you were asking, you know, or asking him questions and expecting an answer. I never heard that anywhere. So in Emmanuel Journaling, what we're teaching people, and it makes a huge difference in their life, is to listen, to ask him specific questions. And I just did it for about 50 people in a class this weekend. Everybody except one person in the class heard. They were writing down what they were hearing from the Lord, even those that didn't think they could hear. But he has a way of meeting us in those places exactly where we need to be. And he answers those questions. And by the time you're done with that, you've got something that is really relational. You know he cares about you because he's giving you answers to questions that you wonder about, and he says that there's something he can do about it, and it's a real joy and faith builder. So that relational, there's the relational part of it, the relational part with God first and then with other people that build it and sustain it. So we love joy. I've got joy all over the place, right? The word says that what I tell people is if you lose it, you know, you lose your strength, because that's what the word says. It says the joy of the Lord is our strength. So if we're not walking in joy, we're missing the vitality and the ability to walk the full life that he meant for us, the fullness of the life that he had for us.
Okay. What if you are a recovering religious addict?
Well, would I?
How do you recover?
That's a good question, right? We got lots of those. Oh, golly. You've been writing prayers. One of the prayers that I wrote a couple years ago was a prayer against cessation, about repentance for cessationism. Right? Because we've got so many people that's what they've been brought up their whole life, right? So I have them repent for back doctrine. And I do it in classes too, and it's like, wow, that was really empowering to read those scriptures, that they really believe that what he says about them is true. Right, and that what he says about the gifts are really true. That's one of the things to do when you get them, is just to have them repent to the Lord about practicing religion without asking him into the picture.
My gosh, you heard it from Barb. If you are a religious addict and you are listening to this program, and you know, because every time you see a joyful Christian, you are miserable and angry at them. How dare they? It's time to repent and renew your mind to the truth that Jesus wants fellowship with you too.
And
begin sowing good seeds into the relational fields around your life. Reap a harvest. You know, Barb, you talked at the beginning and said joy is hooked to healing.
Uh-huh.
Talk to me a little bit more about that.
Well, I mean, there's a whole lot of scriptures when you start unpacking them that talk about joy and healing and deliverance and healing. And just once your eyes get attuned to joy in the scripture, somebody's going to see joy everywhere. It's all through the Psalms, right? Shout for joy. I mean, who? The idea of shouting in a church is you know, pretty not common. We've been doing a lot of shouting these days here. And just building joy in meetings, even, you know, with worship, then going into worship, no question about that as well. But there's a joy part that's not in even many services, right? So we want to do that all the time. And that doesn't answer the question you asked me. What was the question again?
Joy is hooked to healing.
Yes.
That statement. Yes.
Well, they know that, right?
Mm.
I mean, even in, they do have done scientific studies that prayer now is hooked to healing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Peace is hooked to healing, mm-hmm. and joy is hooked to healing. Physically, they know that. They've done studies that show that. But in scripture, it's all together. It's joy, 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 joy. And he talks about being people of joy, right? People of faith and people of joy. All through the Psalms, he talks about joy. Mm-hmm. Shout out, worship me with joy. It's not somber at all. It's really a passionate, joyful worship that's supposed to be there. So that religious spirit, right, will take all of that away. I mean, they'll frown at anything that looks happy in church, right? I mean, that's why the idea of crazy holy laughter is such an anathema, I think, to the religious spirit, because you certainly can't have people laughing in church.
Oh, no.
No.
No. The only emotion considered is weeping.
Yeah. Yeah. And he, yeah, there's another verse in Proverbs that may, I'm going to pull it out because it's a verse that's,
you know, I remember being in a conversation with someone once upon a time, and they were so upset. And so since I'm one of those types, I tend to be a fairly good listener. You know, uh-huh. I just listen to people.
Oh, you have to be doing what you're doing.
Well, I went through a few prerequisites. Yeah. This conversation was one of them. So I'm sitting there listening to this person explain the world to me. Dan Duvall, let me tell you something. Dan Duvall. I heard this person say that they saw Jesus laughing. Can you believe the blasphemy of that statement? Laughing?
Oh, wow.
Where
wow.
did Jesus ever laugh? There's nothing to laugh about when it comes to what's going on in the world and what's going on in their life. And they said they saw. This is why I don't believe these people that say they're seers. What is a seer? That's so New Age. This, see, because Jesus, where does, and I'm just listening to the guy explain the world to me. This is how it works. Right. If someone sees Jesus laughing, then there's a lying spirit at work, or they're in total New Age deception. Barb, how would you respond to this individual?
Man. I don't know. I would just I don't know what you say about somebody like that. Right. You say you need to go to Dan Duvall and get delivered, man. Isn't that the truth? Get delivered from that religious spirit, right? But that's there's so much wrapped up in that spirit, right? It's judgment and it's condemnation, and it certainly does not align itself with the. If anybody reads the scripture honestly and start looking for joy scriptures, they will find them all over. I was just looking at Proverbs 28. It says, The triumphant joy of God's lovers releases great glory. And then a few verses down, it says, overjoyed is the one who with tender heart trembles before God. But the stubborn, unyielding heart will experience even greater evil. But again, overjoyed is the one, right? The triumphant joy of God's lovers releases great glory. That's huge. A joyful heart's another one, brings healing to both body and soul. But the one whose heart is crushed struggles with sickness and depression. That's scripture, right? So it's a joyful, cheerful heart that he says, we better be after that joyful, cheerful heart.
My gosh.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's so appealing to the world, right? I mean, the world is so looking for joy and peace right now with all the confusion. There's another verse in Proverbs 9. Let's see. I think it's 9. Yeah. So listen, my sons and daughters, to everything I tell you. For nothing will bring you more joy than following my ways. It's joy, just joy all over the place. And joy, particularly in the Psalms, it's there. But it's all through the New Testament, too. They were joyful people that he was dealing with, or wanted them to be joyful people. So I know it's the key to bringing people. I love this Philippians verse, be cheerful with joyous celebration in every season of life. Let joy overflow, for you are united with the Anointed One. Let gentleness be seen in every relationship, for our Lord is ever near. So there's that gentleness, right, with each other. Be cheerful with joyful celebration.
Wow.
Up above that it says, my dear and precious friends whom I deeply love, you have truly become my glorious joy and crown of reward. Once you start looking for joyful scriptures, they're everywhere. But that's a missing piece in the church, joy and peace, right? So that's what we're working for, is to bring people, getting them free is beautiful, but getting them to walk in freedom with joy and peace is the key, I believe, to it.
I'm so glad we did this program, Barb, because, you know, I mean, like I think many leaders, you know, I don't spend a lot of time highlighting on this podcast the importance of joy. As a matter of fact, this is the first joy podcast I've ever done, just to focus on this one subject. Now, granted, I haven't done a single podcast on the subject of peace either.
That would be good.
So maybe that's what we need to do the next time. Because, you know, but it just needs to be highlighted. And
absolutely.
You know, you brought so many really solid nuggets to the table in this conversation. I want to ask, is there anything on the subject of joy that you wanted to highlight that I haven't specifically asked you yet?
The thing that's most in my mind is that the Lord has made us so that you can retrain your brain and rewire it, actually, and get it out of the old ruts and patterns that we're in by doing what I know are some really simple exercises to build joy. Jim Wilder and a guy by the name of Chris Corsi have done a lot of work in that level, and they actually teach people those exercises that are life-changing. And down at Max Lucado's church in San Antonio, there's one of the pastors down there has written a little book that's called Building Better Community. And what he's done is just basically written 12 exercises that they're going to use in their small groups. Really simple, like telling people that you're glad to be with them, or just smiling. And those are the first ones, right? And telling joy stories to each other. and looking at people in the eye, because there are a lot of people that can't, you know, that they can't do that. And part of that, I believe, is that fear that comes in with them of that eye contact. But building, being able to unpack that eye contact with each other is the way you can download joy to somebody else. It's physical and it's measurable. So to know that the Lord given us some keys to do that for people who find themselves in that low joy place, and know that your brain is still changing, particularly that right front area where your joy bucket is, and you can, even though you've been lacking in that area, you can do things to rebuild joy so that you become, we walk in the fullness of the joy that He has for you. So you're never in a place of hopelessness, right? But there's always the hope of having more and more of it, which is contagious, right? And it spreads through a family. So it's like, oh, wow, you're one of our tribe. You're joyful, right? It's really beautiful. And part of that, I think, comes from just hearing the voice of the Lord, knowing that He's there and He cares about what you're doing. That's the most important relationship.
Man. Folks.
So we're passionate about joy. When you come to Austin, we'll just do whatever we can to build your joy, Dan.
I'll receive it. I will receive it, you know. I mean, because I've certainly had enough people try to take it. So it's nice to be on the receiving end from time to time. It's like, oh, here we go. These are my people.
Yeah, right.
And I
had this happen before, right?
Yeah. And eye contact is really so good. I have two stories here. One, I was recently in Toronto, and one of the things the Lord prompted me to do while I was there was a little, it was just a small, simple activation, but there was, you know, a heavy presence on me, you know, leading up to when I did this. And what I did was I just had everybody get in a line and walk to the front. And one by one, I looked everyone in the eye and just told them, mm-hmm. I love you, you know. And the responses to that were interesting. I mean, some people wept deeply. It was like a moment of healing. Bet. And being able to just look someone in the eye and say something positive, like, I'm glad to see you. I love you. I'm so glad you're here. You know, I mean, for some of us, that's life. I mean, that's like we haven't had life like that in a long time. And
that's
another
right.
point, we did these survivor support groups for those that are connected with our ministry. Now, for those of you that listen to this, these are not public. So don't look for them on our website. You won't find it there. But, you know, we do have these private groups. And we were doing them a certain way where we would have, it would like a support group where everybody gives an update, right? So we would mm-hmm. start the meetings off with an update, like, what's been going on in your life? How are you doing? Well, you know what that turned mm-hmm. into? Whine and complain central. As a matter of fact, Uh-oh. It was so bad that people would intentionally be an hour late to the meeting, so they didn't have to hear anyone else whine and complain.
They didn't want to hear that.
But they would time it so that they could get in to get their in, you know, so they could complain. They just didn't want to have to listen to everybody else complain. And we figured this out after a while. I was like, all right, half of you aren't even showing up until this, like, every 5 minutes, starting at 45 minutes in.
You know? Oh, how funny.
And so.
That is hilarious.
Because
is hilarious.
It is, isn't it, though?
So that's not exactly the kind of testimony that God is after, right?
So we changed everything. It was like, wipe the slate.
Yeah.
We're like, this is not working. Now we have a new system. Okay, and we start with conversation. We always have conversation topics in our groups, and we talk about things that are relevant and real, raw, and helpful. And then we talk about testimonies of good things.
Uh-huh.
So no one's actually allowed to just sit there and give the sob story because everyone has one. And then we
right.
do prayer requests at the end. But instead of giving the sob story about why everything is breaking down, you just reword it as a prayer request that goes in the chat box where, you know, you don't have to, it works so much better. And there is more of an environment of joy, and everyone finds it more positive. It's amazing.
That's awesome.
So joy.
That's awesome, because those, one of those things that telling stories that bring people back to joy is really key, right? Even talking about circumstances that you were in that brought you joy, right? And just sharing pictures, that's some of the easy things that you can do with people to remind them of who they really were meant to be, right?
Is there a connection?
When they had those five-bar moments with the Lord.
Yeah.
When they were full of joy and peace and secure, that's really key to getting people healed, is to remember those things and start with them, right?
Is there a connection between joy and humor?
Oh, I think so.
Aha.
Don't you?
Well, it would make sense.
Yeah. Yeah, because I think there's a lightness that comes to joy that you can see the... You're just geared towards seeing the positive and the fun part of things. You know, it's like taking a little four-year-old part and giving that little four-year-old part just the permission to be a child, right? If
yes.
It's a wounded child, and
yes.
Building joy and doing fun things and saying things that are just really never maybe allowed to say before. All those things, you know, play into humor, I think. So it's not the sarcastic kind of humor and deadly humor, right? The kind that's devastating, but it's humor that sees the beauty in things, that's attached to the goodness of God and the goodness of people, not the kind that is going to take advantage of their weaknesses but build their strengths.
I think that's, you know, as I think about it, I think that humor is actually tied to joy, which is why people find themselves attracted to funny people, because
mm-hmm.
it makes them feel good.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I also think, and I want to hear your thoughts on this, that hospitality is tied to joy.
Totally. Totally.
And people...
I can't agree with you more.
People that have a gift of hospitality can be real joy builders
mm-hmm.
in the kingdom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, joy is infectious.
Mm.
Peace is too. And people are looking for both, but joy is infectious. You can. We walked into a house not very long ago, actually, and it was like everybody had lost their people skills.
Oh no!
You know, they really. I was with someone and we looked at each other and we said, are they really glad we're here? Or would they really rather have this evening all by themselves and not have any people in the house with them? Have you ever walked in a place and felt that way?
Oh no, not me.
We really don't
no.
feel welcome at all.
No.
And I thought, oh, and these were the people that we were visiting were in their early 30s. And I thought, does that sort of come with all the screens that they don't have the grace to welcome you and make you feel welcome and at home?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I mean, it really made me wonder. I hadn't felt that way in a long time, but I hadn't. And the, of course, the television was on all the time we were there, which to me, I don't have television. I hadn't had it for years. But to me, that's a real distractor from building relationships, right? Because everybody's focused on the screen. You're not looking at anybody in the eyes.
True.
You're talking about something that isn't reality for most of the time if you're looking at the screen. Yeah. So those real relationships then are built on caring for people and being able to focus on how they feel, right? Understanding that, and your desire always is to bring people, even if you're doing memory work with them, you really always want to bring them back to that place of peace and joy. That's the healing piece, right?
Yes.
In memories.
Yes.
To bring them out, but then to bring them out into the light where they really, really feel joy again, feel a lightness, something changes. when they see the lie in a memory or see that Jesus was with them in there and suddenly they're secure, that brings joy and peace into their situation.
So good.
That's the joy of the work. You know, we say it all the time around here. The Lord said real clearly, there's joy in the journey, right? To stay awake and stay alert and watch for the, just walk through this in joy, because as situations get tougher, right, around us, which we see, the dark is going to get darker, right? That's what the word says. But it, to me, arise and shine means, well, you better have joy in that arise and shining. That's what it looks like to me. The deep darkness may cover the earth, but the glory of the Lord, I don't see glory on gloom or depression or hopeless despair. Glory is with joy and peace.
Mm-hmm.
The ability to attract others to Christ. Those are game changers for people.
Barb, this has been really, really good. Folks, Barb and her team work with folks that need physical healing, inner healing, deliverance. She doesn't work alone. There's a team of people around her and connected to her ministry. You can reach out through their website at luke-418.com. But they're booked. I mean, kind of like me. Kind of hard to get an appointment. But that's because they're doing something right. And so, you know, Barb, I just want to open the door for you to let our listening audience know anything that you want them to about your ministry, anything that you want them to maybe pay attention to when they go to your website and so forth.
Well, we've got a batch of testimonies on there. We've always wanted to do that. We're in a position now where we've built a little bit. We also had a man come through deliverance about a year ago, and it turned out that he was a filmmaker and he just got radically free. It's just wonderful. Now he's sitting at the table helping other people get free himself. But he came back about a month after his deliverance and told us that the Lord told him to do a documentary on Luke 4:18. So he put a film together. All we had to do was show up with some testimonies, and he did everything else, paid for everything. It was amazing, right? Only the Lord could do that. So they might be interested in seeing that as well as the testimonies of the ministry. And then for me, it's just people are aware that there's always hope, right? That nothing is too hard for the Lord. All the diagnoses go, all the mental diagnoses. We've had people that have gone home from nursing homes that were so angry and radical, and they got delivered, right? And so we look at everything, as the word says, right? Anything is possible. Everything is possible. When Jesus walks in the room, things change. And so we look, whether it's an addiction or whether it's depression, whatever it is, and so much of it is tied, as you know, and I'm sure the people listening know, so much of it is tied to breaking off generational curses as well and getting those iniquities out of the way, which we try to do the first time we see people, so that we can unpack who they were really meant to be without any issues. One thing about the joy, which is interesting, is I have a friend doing his doctorate in theology, and so he's, because of the stuff that we've been talking about and this conversation that I've had with him, he's doing it on joy.
Oh.
And he said that he could really only find two books in all the Christian stuff that were really written about joy. So it's even missing in literature, practically no research about it in the Christian field at all, no conversation about it. So he's going to do a study in the city and track people's joy records. Start them at one point, have them do certain things in a 6-month, 9-month period, and see if joy levels change. And that's, I think, is going to be great fun to watch that happen, watch that develop.
That is too funny. I mean, even when I was in Bible school, they had courses on covenant, courses on gifts of the Spirit, courses on healing, but there's no course on joy.
None.
And I was at a Spirit-filled Bible school.
But there wasn't one on peace either.
Yeah, right. But I mean, I was at a Spirit-filled Bible school, and I mean, I don't discredit them for anything. There was joy in the things that we did there. It just wasn't a class on it. But yeah. I mean, at some of these seminaries, oh my gosh, Barb.
Oh my gosh, right.
You know.
Joyless.
Absolutely. I went, I'm just going to share this and then, we'll probably close out the program. But I remember when I was getting ready to look at colleges in high school, I was looking at a few. And I, of course, ended up going to Ohio State. But one of the schools that I visited was a Christian college that I'll leave the name of out of this recording. But I went to this Christian college and visited the campus for 24 hours. And, you spend all night in one of the dorms and you meet some of the people on campus and, you go around and it's an experience where you get acquainted, So I did this, and when my mom picked me up 24 hours later, she was like, "What happened to you? You're so down and depressed." And I'm like, I don't know. But now I do know. I spent 24 hours in the presence of a heavy-duty religious spirit.
Yeah.
And I was floundering, yeah. Barb. I was floundering.
That's deadening, right? Talk about it, something that'll steal your joy, right? Put you into it. Yeah. Oh, that could lead you to hopeless despair real fast.
Oh, come on now.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad you did go there.
Me too.
Yeah.
Me too. Folks, let me tell you something. Yeah. Barb Bucklin is a very, very special lady. And if you want to get a hold of their DVD, it's actually called Road to Freedom. And that's on their website. There's a little tab at luke-418.com. It says Road to Freedom. That's where you can get the information on how to order the DVD. Other than that, I just want to say thank you, Barb. Thank you for taking the time to hang out with me for a little while.
Well, it was great fun. It filled my joy bucket.
Amen. Yeah. Mine too.
Filled yours and some of the people that are listening. It added a little joy and hope along the way.
Amen. Folks, you've been listening to Discovering the Truth with Dan Duvall. Until next time, God bless and Godspeed. You've been listening to Discovering the Truth with Dan Duvall. If you would like to connect with us at Bride Ministries or to support what we are doing financially, visit us at www.bridemovement.com.